Good morning. We are going to go over two models involving two equations and two unknowns and perform the full stability analysis on paper and then on maple. As you know already, those of you who take this class in the summer, this week it's kind of the most condensed week because now we move on to systems of differential equations. And as I mentioned before, we will focus in this class to models that are, to begin with, involving two differential equations, or models that can be reduced by various means to two equations, so that we can deal only with two equations when it comes to perform the stability analysis. So at this point, I'm going to assume that you went over the notes, or those of you who didn't take the class, I'm going to assume that you know how to perform partial derivatives and then basically how to compute the determinant and the trace of a 2x2 matrix. I mean, even if you didn't know this before you actually watch this video, I'll just summarize briefly, and I hope it's going to come up pretty obvious once we do the example. That's not the difficult part. I think the difficult part for those of you who learn this for the first time is to actually understand what the point of the analysis is and what is the goal in the end. I mean, what's the answer, so to speak, to the problem. Part of the challenge is that many students are used to questions or exercises in which there's a question and the answer is usually a number or a function. So there's a precise quantity to find, you know, like the problem says, here's the thing, find this, and then there's usually an equation, then you perform some operations, maybe integration, maybe other math operations, and then you will provide a specific answer. What it needs to be understood is that when we talk about local stability analysis or stability analysis in general, is that the goal is a discussion. Is a discussion on parameter values. Or I should say parameters ranges, not values. So the answer is not a specific number. And a generic model obviously involves lots of parameters, not just one like you see in this starting example. And I always teach this part with an example involving only one parameter because it's easier to handle on paper and it's easier to understand what the point is in terms of the goal of the problem. But then after that, when we move on to more generic models, you should realize that the conditions that you derive in this analysis, of course, involve all the parameters, or sometimes not all necessarily, but more than one parameter in the model. So why do I say a discussion? Well, because the framework is the following. Remember, the goal is to predict the outcome. So at the very least, you should look at the equilibrium points, that is the points where both derivatives are equal to zero, and to see whether each of these points is stable or not and under what conditions. I should say actually even that's quite important. The question is not whether the point is stable or not. The question is under what conditions you have a point stable or unstable. It is true in some cases that some equilibrium points are always stable or unstable regardless of the parameter values, but this is what we try to discover. Do we have such a situation? And if we don't, are there any conditions on the parameters that will dictate what the outcome is, stability or instability of the equilibrium? So the answer is not a number. The answer is essentially a list of outcomes depending on ranges of the parameters. You will end up the problem by saying, if alpha, in this case, this parameter belongs to this interval or satisfies this condition, then this particular equilibrium point is stable, which means we can predict that at least if we start close to that equilibrium point, the solution approaches that point. So mathematically speaking, there are essentially three main, well, let's see, there are several main steps, right? So finding the equilibria, if any, that means we're going to set up the right-hand side equal to zero, and then find the possible constant solutions. Then you're going to compute the Jacobian, which is the matrix of partial derivatives of the right-hand side. Again, those of you who took differential equations courses, you know, have more in-depth knowledge of what that means. If you didn't take differential equations, you just basically take this as a formula for analysis. So we don't have to go too deep into how that Jacobian comes to be, to play a role, right? It's really like, it's essentially linearization, right? I mean, it's approximating a nonlinear system with a linear one, and the Jacobian is nothing but the matrix of that approximating linear system. So once we compute the Jacobian in the 2x2 case, so we're going to evaluate Jacobian at each equilibrium point. And then for each equilibrium point, you're going to see under what condition the trace of the matrix is negative and the determinant is positive. So this is what I cover in this class, the stability condition for a 2x2 system. There are lots of borderline cases which I don't get into. So for example, notice these are strict inequalities. That's not a coincidence. So if the trace is zero or the determinant is zero, those are borderline cases that need to be dealt with by separate means mathematically, and we don't go over that situation. And maybe I'm going to comment a little bit on why actually in many modeling problems these borderline cases are not that important unless you're looking specifically to some special properties like bifurcation in which you want to figure out whether the entire behavior of the model can change drastically if one parameter or more than one parameter passes a certain critical point. But for now, just remember that we're looking for both of these conditions to be satisfied to establish that the respective point is stable. Another thing to keep in mind is when we find the equilibrium point, immediately we should ask ourselves whether it is biologically feasible. Remember that the math doesn't care about biology, basically. So just because you have an equilibrium point, it doesn't mean that it has any relevance in terms of the model predictions. Biologically feasible, in our case, most of the time, that means whether it is positive or not. Because if it's negative, then it's outside the biological domain. If the model is well posed, if it's valid, remember we studied how to figure out the validity of a model, then you will never get to an equilibrium that is negative if you start with positive initial conditions. So basically, the biological feasibility is the default condition to be imposed or to verify once we find an equilibrium point. And that, you will see, basically gives us usually additional conditions on the parameters. So with that in mind, let's proceed with the analysis of the model here. So this is an example of a predator-prey model. For instance, if you want some justification, because the parameters are not necessarily realistic, so I'm not going to pretend these are real life numbers or an actual population, but imagine that you have a prey population denoted by X, which in the absence of the predator follows a logistic equation format. So if you discard Y, X times 100 minus X is just a logistic growth rate. So for instance, the population will approach 100 level if you don't have predation. Then you have the predation, which is kind of similar to an infection process. Now, because I want to keep a single parameter in the equation, I keep the same parameter here, because normally these two parameters are different. The predation effect is not the same as the energy gain from the predator. So why is the predator? This basically denotes the efficiency of killing the prey. This will be the efficiency of getting energy or food resources in terms of growth from the prey. And these two are not the same, right? I mean, the energy gain is not identical to the killing effect of the prey. Basically, for instance, some predators can waste a lot of prey and gain very little energy. For instance, they eat only a small portion of it. Or they have to kill a lot of prey to gain a corresponding unit of energy in terms of the growth. For example, a whale is such an example, right? I mean, the whale needs to eat, because it eats only small fish, it needs to swallow a huge amount of little fish for a correspondingly, you know, unit of energy gain in the food. This will be the death rate of the prey, of the predator. And notice that in the absence of prey, the predator dies out exponentially. That's again something that can be realistic in some situations if you talk about a predator that is that depends completely on the prey. So let's go to the first step when we find the equilibrium points. And I should point out it's very important when we're done with this on paper to actually follow the videos that I'm going to end up with this presentation, because I'm going to go over these examples on Maple to see how you could do this with the Maple assistance to speed up the process, which is very important if you have more than one parameter, since stuff can get very quickly tedious if you don't use technology to do some of the computations. Okay, so we set the both right-hand side equal to zero to find the equilibrium points. And notice that I can factor. There's no rule on how to start, but usually start with the easier equation that you can factor. Notice I can factor y on the second equation. And then from the second equation, I have two possibilities, y1 equals 0, or independently, alpha, so y equals 0, which gives me one equilibrium point, or alpha x minus 5 equals 0, which gives me, let me actually just count them later. So y equals 0, or alpha x minus 5 equals 0, which means x equals 5 over alpha. We can number the equilibrium points later, because it's important to make sure you pair them correctly and not miss any possible equilibrium point. So second equation is zero if two conditions can happen, either of them, right? Either y zero or x equals 5 over alpha. And again, let's assume that alpha is strictly positive as the predation rate. So now in each case, you have to go back to the first equation and see the value of the other variable. So if y equals zero, I go back to the first equation, and then I'm left with x times 100 minus x equals 0, which gives me x equals 0 or x equals 100. So pause for a moment and realize that we already found two equilibrium points. One, a 0, 0. So you can pair x equals 0 with y equals 0. 100, 0. X equals 100, y equals 0. It's very important to find all equilibrium points, because when you do the analysis, you may end up with weird conclusions in terms of the range of alpha. You may have gaps in the analysis when you would say, well, what if alpha is in this range? What happens? And if you miss an equilibrium point, then that's where the gap comes from. So now we go back to x equals 5 over alpha. And this is the part when basically you may need to use Maple if it gets more complicated. Essentially, when you do this, you should have the paper in front of you and the computer algebra system also running. So 5 over alpha, I'm going to plug in x with 5 over alpha, replace x with 5 over alpha, equals, let's move alpha x y to the right-hand side, alpha times 5 over alpha times y. Okay, so we can cancel 5 over alpha, and then common denominator on the left side is alpha, so I can bring it into a single fraction, and then y equals 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha squared. So this gives me the third equilibrium point in the order xy. That's important to keep the order of the variables, so 5 over alpha for x, and 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha squared is my third equilibrium point. So notice, and by the way, in the language of ecology, this will be the coexistence equilibrium, because at that equilibrium, both species are non-zero. This will be extinction of both prey and predator. It's kind of a messy arrangement here, but 100, 0, this will be prey extinction, predator extinction, right? Because the prey stays at 100 and the predator goes away. Remember what I said about the biological feasibility. It's very important each time when you find an equilibrium point is to ask yourself, is it biologically feasible or not? This, no problem. I mean, zero is feasible, by the way, because zero means the population can go extinct, which there's no contradiction, biologically speaking. What you don't want are strictly negative quantities here. So notice that this coexistence equilibrium, so the coexistence is feasible only if 100 alpha minus 5 is positive. Let me call it actually positive, because feasibility in our context means, in this case, just positive. So you already have a condition that the coexistence, and you should save this basically on your notes somewhere when you put everything together at the end. So coexistence is feasible only if alpha times 100 minus 5 is greater than 0, which is equivalent to alpha less than 5 over 100, which is 0.05. So coexistence exists only, so the coexistence equilibrium exists only if alpha is less than 0.05. And at all points, you should, how should I put it? You should challenge your condition or the result against whether it makes sense from a real perspective. Because, again, don't just be satisfied by a numerical answer. Does it make sense to say, so we have to always translate this in terms of biology, right? Does it make sense to say that if predation is less than a certain level, then the predator goes extinct? Yes, it makes sense. It wouldn't make sense if it's the other way around, right? Because to say, if you go back to the model, to say that the predation is too low, I mean lower than a certain value, you could imagine that, yes, indeed, maybe if the predation is not big enough, not enough food comes into the predator population, death continues to be exponentially decreasing. So I mean, in the exponential fashion here, so therefore you could imagine that at some point, if the predator is not efficiently killing the prey, it'll go extinct. Whereas the prey continues to go via the logistic growth rate toward 100. The reason you should ask this in terms of whether it makes sense biologically is because you can spot computation mistakes. Because the computation mistakes always, or nearly always, will suggest stuff that won't make sense biologically. Not always, because sometimes you can have, you know, unusual or counterintuitive results that can still be explained biologically. But that's when you have a paper, basically, when you have some interesting results worthy of a publication, if it's correct but counterintuitive. With that being said, let's move on to the Jacobian. So let's see, probably we should keep, let's keep it in the same part. And I'm going to write again the system here to have it in front of us. And for the purpose of computing the Jacobian, I will, you know, expand this parenthesis. All right, and let's compute the Jacobian. So the Jacobian, which sometimes is denoted by J of XY, is the matrix of the partial derivatives. So the partial derivative of the with respect to X, it's going to be 100 minus 2X minus alpha y. With respect to y, this goes away because it doesn't depend on y, that's minus alpha x. With respect to x, we have alpha y. And with respect to y, second equation, that's alpha x minus 5. And now for each equilibrium point, we're going to plug that point into the Jacobian and evaluate the trace and the determinant. Okay, so let's start with the easy one. The more zeros you have, obviously for x or y, the easier it gets. So for the extinction equilibrium, if I plug it in, that's going to be 100, 0, 0, minus 5. The trace, which is the sum of the elements on the main diagonal, is 95, which is positive. The determinant is minus 500, which is negative. Remember, you could stop at the trace, basically, because for stability, both the trace should be negative and the determinant should be positive. So I could have actually stopped at the trace only and concluded that the point is unstable. You may wonder, what's the difference if you have the trace positive and the determinant positive as opposed to negative? So the shape of the solution, the geometry of the solution varies depending on the signs of these, but the point is, overall, the solution in general doesn't approach the extinction state. It's unstable. There are some nuances to this which I don't want to get into it, but again, for now, the negation, or if either the trace is positive or the determinant is negative, then the point is unstable. So you could conclude that overall, in this particular model, you will never have the situation in which both species go extinct. So no extinction for both is the conclusion. Now, the second equilibrium point that we computed, the predator extinction. So now we replace y with 0 and x with 100. And let's simplify a little bit. That gives me minus 100, minus 100 alpha, 0, 100 alpha minus 5. All right, so this is another little trick of the trade to pay attention, because this will happen often. When you compute the trace and the determinant, don't rush to simplify. And especially if you have one of the entries equal to 0, look at the determinant first. Once again, those of you who took linear algebra and know stuff about eigenvalues, you could go this differently in a much more direct if you want, but I don't want to get into that, because remember, the goal is to make this class with only calculus one prerequisite. So just look at the determinant first and don't simplify it. Just keep it in the factor form, because the analysis is far easier this way. So don't expand unless there is a need to. So remember, one stability condition is the determinant to be positive. So this is the moment when the answer is neither stable nor unstable. It depends. It can be stable or unstable depending on a certain condition. So if the determinant is positive, which is equivalent, notice, because you have minus 100, this negative coefficient, which is equivalent to 100 alpha minus 5 less than 0. So to be positive determinant, you need the parentheses to be negative, because multiply by minus 100 makes it positive. So if 100 minus alpha less minus 5 is less than 0, then the determinant will be positive. So 100 alpha minus 5 less than 0 is the same as saying determinant positive. And this is the part that makes you understand and, you know, pause and rewind if you need to. Notice that this condition automatically makes the trace positive. Negative. Because the first entry of the trace is already negative. If the second entry is also negative, negative plus negative makes it negative. So this is also less than 0 if 100 alpha minus 5 less than 0. So in other words, 100, 0 is stable if 100 alpha minus 5 is less than 0. Okay. So I was looking at a different... Yeah, I was looking at a different part for a moment and I got distracted. So 100 alpha minus psi is less than zero means the determinant is positive. The part that is confusing here, and especially if you do this stuff with Maple, is because if you simplify the trace, this can get quite complicated and you won't be able to see that it's made of two entries, one of them reflecting the sign of the determinant. So especially when the determinant can be factored, like in this case, start with the determinant, see under what condition that determinant is positive, and see whether that actually gives you already the condition that the trace is negative. So in other words, the trace doesn't bring you anything new to the table. The trace follows negative immediately if the determinant is positive. So in other words, determinant positive implied in this case trace negative. And so therefore both conditions of stability are satisfied by a single inequality. So we're going to have predator extinction if 100 alpha minus 5 is less than 0, which is the same as alpha less than 0.05. Did I say something wrong? Because that's why I got distracted. So I have to make a correction. Sorry about that. I'll make that in the comment as well. For some reason, I don't know why I did that. So notice that when I said feasibility, I thought that something is wrong with it. So 100 alpha minus 5 greater than 0 means alpha greater than 0.05. Sorry about that. So the coexistence, happens only if alpha is greater than 0.05, because that's the inequality here. 100 alpha greater than 5, alpha greater than 5 over 100, alpha greater than 0.05. And going back to this, predator extinction if alpha is less than 0.05. All right, so let's move on finally with the last equilibrium point. We're going to plug in, and this will be a little bit more tedious, we're going to plug in 5 over alpha for x, and what was the other value? 100 alpha minus 5 divided by alpha squared for y. So this will be x, this will be y in the Jacobian. And let's see if we can put it in the same frame. There's the Jacobian. So in this case, we have 100 minus 2 times 5 over alpha minus alpha times 100 alpha minus 5 divided by alpha squared, and then minus alpha x, and then alpha y, alpha x minus 5. Remember that this guy exists only if alpha is greater than 0.05, and notice already, because that's actually important, this condition is opposite to the predator extinction condition. So again, hopefully or fortunately, this can be done by hand, but again, this is the part that you may want to use Maple to assist yourself if you have too many variables here that you need to handle. We'll get to that in due course. Let's actually simplify it by hand for now. So we have 100 minus 10 over alpha minus 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha, because we can cancel an alpha. This corner is minus 5. This is 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha. And this corner happens to be 0, which is again good because it will simplify our analysis a little bit. We can simplify this further. The common denominator is alpha, so on the left corner is 100 alpha minus 10 minus 100 alpha plus 5 divided by alpha and minus 5, and then 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha and 0. 100 alpha cancels, this would be minus 5. Let's write everything on the second page, or the next page, so to speak. in this center here. So then the Jacobian at this equilibrium becomes minus 5 over alpha minus 5 100 alpha minus 5 divided by alpha and 0. Alright, so notice in this case that the trace is by default negative. That doesn't bring us any new conditions to the table. Okay, minus 5 over alpha plus 0 is negative because alpha is always positive as a biological parameter. The trace is always negative. So the stability conditions comes from the determinant, which remember is product of the main diagonal minus the product of the other diagonal. And so this becomes 5 times 100 alpha minus 5 over alpha greater than 0. This is already established from existence. So true from biological condition. We knew that this equilibrium point only matters to us if is in the biological domain. So remember the equilibrium value was this, which to make it relevant for us meant that we have to assume alpha greater than 0.05, this corner, and that automatically implies that the determinant is positive. So we could say here in this case that this this equilibrium is stable whenever it exists biologically. That means whenever it is positive. So this completes the analysis. So what we showed in the end is that this value, 0.05 for alpha, completely determines the outcome of the model. So when you basically write down your conclusion in terms of the modeling work, you would say that what we concluded is the following. Extinction of both predator and prey not possible. The second conclusion, if alpha is less than 0.05, predator goes extinct. And the third conclusion, if alpha is greater than 0.05, predator prey likely to coexist, right? So they approach a positive equilibrium point. And notice that there is no gap in analysis. Sometimes there are gaps because the math doesn't work, or maybe there is a mistake, but there is no gap because these are all the possible ranges for alpha. I mean, in other words, covers all the possibilities for alpha. Most of the basic models will end up with this type of feature. And the epidemic models, as you will see in the next example, is similar as well, in the sense that everything boils down essentially to some threshold value, to a not a single parameter, but a combination of parameters. So in more complicated models, when you have more than one parameters, you still, in most of the basic models, you're going to have basically some sort of critical value, but that will be for a combination of parameters and not for a single parameter. So with that in mind, we're going to move on to the second part to do the same for an epidemic model. So stay tuned.